Good afternoon, students. Welcome to the live lecture of functional analysis. In the last lecture, we have completed the proof of Hahn-Banach-Lehmann for both the cases, that is for a real linear space or real non-linear space or complex non-linear spaces. What this lemma is going to tell us? That whenever we have a functional defined on the subspace of the given normal linear space, then we can extend it to a functional on the next space adjoining a point, one point to the base, correct? No? That is, if M is the subspace of a nonlinear space, F is the functional defined, then by taking a point x naught, which is not in M, and we will adjoin, that is, we will find out the space spanned by M and x naught, say M naught, then the function F can be extended to F naught. This we have seen in the last lecture. Now in today's Hahn-Banach theorem, what we were going to see? We were going to see whether the functional can be extended to a functional capital F on the whole linear space or not. Okay. Yesterday we have discussed this idea also, what the Hahn-Banach theorem is going to tell us. Let me write the statement of this theorem and we will go for its proof. Let me write Hahn-Banach theorem. Okay, the statement says that let capital M be linear subspace of a normed linear space capital N and F be a linear functional. Defined on M. Okay. Defined on M. Prove that F can be extended to a functional capital F defined on capital N and such that norm of F is equals to norm of capital F. Okay, this is the structure. Na, small f is the small n is the subspace of a nonlinear space N. F is the functional defined. Now our aim is to show that this functional can be extended to a functional F on M such that it satisfies the condition. Okay, now to prove the results, what we will do by Hahn-Banach lemma. Actually, we have proved that if there is one element x naught in N, not in M, then the space spanned by M and x naught, we have written M naught, and we have given the existence of the functional F naught on M naught. Therefore, if it is possible that M naught is equal to N, that is, the whole linear space is formed by using the space spanned by M and x naught, then may I say Hahn-Banach theorem will hold automatically? There were two cases to be discussed actually. In the first case, we will discuss if M naught equals to N, nothing to prove, no? Because if M naught is equals to N, already we have proved that there exists an extension F naught, a functional F naught on M naught, which will act as a functional on the whole space N. Okay? The question arises, what happens if M naught is not equal to N? Then we have to go for the proof by using this statement of Zorn's lemma. Okay. Yes, everyone getting me now? Two cases to be considered. Right? Okay. Now let me write this case one. If M naught is equal to N. If M naught is equal to N, may I say the result follows by the lemma? Then the result follows by the lemma. Okay, question arises only if this M naught is not equals to N. That is, M naught is proper subspace of N, one can say. Okay, now if M naught is proper subspace of N, then one can say that repeat the process of adjoining an element, as of we have discussed earlier. Repeat this process of adjoining the element to the previous space and then just go on continue. But what is the guarantee that by this successive extension we get the whole space N? Is it okay? This is the question, and this question is solved by the John's lemma. Therefore, we were proving this by the John's lemma. Therefore, we will write just simply, we have to repeat. We have to repeat the process of extension but what is the guarantee that we will get the extension to the whole space here? Okay, we will get the extension to whole space N. This is the question. Therefore, we are going to prove this by using John's lemma. Here I will write, we use John's lemma to prove this. What John's lemma tells us? Yes, let me write this statement in a quotation. If X is a partially ordered set, X is a partially ordered set in which totally ordered subset into bracket chain has an upper bound then X has a maximal element. This lemma is giving the guarantee for the existence of the maximal element of the corresponding set. Okay, now we will just go exactly by the statement of this John's lemma. That is, initially we will construct one set, we will define one relation, we will show that this is a partially ordered set, then we will consider one totally ordered subset, we will show that the subset has upper bound, then which will give me the existence of the maximal element of the corresponding set. Okay, so let me define the set P. Let P be the collection of ordered pair, say M dash F dash. Ordered pair, say M dash F dash, such that M dash is subspace of N containing capital M, and F dash is an extension of F such that norm of F dash is equals to norm of F. Is it okay? What kind of set we have constructed? Yes, we have considered this to be the subspace M dash of N such that which is containing M, and whatever the functional F dash defined, this will be an extension of this kind of sets we will consider. This will be the set under the consideration. Next is, we have to define one relation, okay, and we have to show the relation is partial order relation. But here I will write, we define a relation less equal on the set P by. What kind of relation I am going to define? Say M dash F dash is less equal by M double dash F double dash if and only. What is if and only if I am going to define? M dash is a subspace of M double dash and what is the meaning of F dash? F double dash is equals to F dash on M dash. What is the meaning of this? What is the meaning of the statement? F double dash is equals to F dash on M dash. Yes, students.
F double dash is extension of F dash.
Very good. This implies F double dash is an extension of F dash. Okay. Suppose the set we were going to define with this. M dash F dash is less equal by M double dash F double dash provided M dash is a subspace of M double dash and F double dash is an extension of F dash. Now before going to see whether this relation okay. Let us show first it is a partial order relation. Now the proof of partial order relation, I'm not going to involve in the main proof. We are going to write directly this is the partial order relation. But for the sake of showing you, let me write it here to prove that the relation is partial order. How many conditions to check? Reflexive,
antisymmetric and transitive.
Right. So let me show the first A related to A now. Wait a minute. That is what we wanted to show. M dash F dash related to itself. Correct, no? Now may I say M dash is a subspace of itself and F dash is an extension of itself. Therefore, this is obviously true. Is it okay? M dash is subspace
yes,
of M dash itself. F dash is extension of itself. Second, what should I show in anti-symmetricity?
B related to A implies A equal to B.
Implies A equal to B. That is, what I have? M dash F dash. Say less equal by M double dash, F double dash. And one more times M double dash, F double dash. Yes? Related to?
M dash F dash.
M dash F dash. Now check. What this statement gives you, M dash is subspace of M double dash. Second relation gives you M double dash is subspace of M dash. Therefore, if both are the subspaces of one other, what can I write?
They are
equal. Secondly, F double dash is an extension of F dash. And F dash is an extension of F double dash. Therefore, may I say these two are same again? Therefore, anti-symmetricity hold. Let me go for third. A related to B, B related to C implies A related to C. That is, say M dash F dash related to M double dash F double dash and M double dash F double dash is related to some M triple dash F triple dash C. Okay, what this says, M dash is subspace of M double dash. Okay, and what this says, M double dash is subspace of M triple dash. So combinedly, can I say M dash is subspace of M triple dash? Okay, then F double dash is an extension of F dash. F triple dash is an extension of F double dash. Therefore, may I say F triple dash is an extension of F dash? Is it okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Therefore, transitivity holds. Therefore, combining all the three, we can say very easily that this relation is a partial order relation. Here we will say this relation less equal is partial ordered relation. On which a set P. Therefore, may I say set P is partially ordered set, that is coset, no? Also, one has to check whether the set is empty because we cannot do any calculation with an empty set. We should have a non-empty set in our hand. Whether this set you feel as an empty set, we at least have this one element of M, F, because M itself is given to be the linear subspace of N and F is a functional defined on the space M. Therefore, may I say MF is an element of the set P, which is already given. Okay. Here I can add also since MF be an element of P. Therefore, can I say P is non-empty poset? Is it okay? Because according to John's lemma, we have found one poset. Now we will find out totally ordered subset. For that, let me define one subset and we will show it is totally ordered. Okay, let S be the subset we were defining. Let S, which is say a element MIFI, okay, this is the set, be totally ordered subset. Subset of P. Why the set is totally ordered? Suppose there are few elements. Let me explain. Don't write it in the proof. Suppose there are few elements. M written first. No? M1, F1. Say M2, F2. Say MN, FN. These are few elements of the set SSA. Then I want to check whether the two elements are comparable or not. That is, whether M1, F1 is less equal by M2, F2. Whether M1 is related to M2 or this is related. This is comparable. Therefore, may I say either M1, F1 will be related to M2, F2. Or M2, F2 is related to M1, F1.
Yes, ma'am.
Correct, na? Because both cannot hold simultaneously. Why both cannot hold simultaneously? Because if I want to say this relation has to hold, then M1 is a subspace of M2 and F2 is an extension of M1. But if I want to say this holds, either M1 is subset of M2 or M2 is subset of M1. Can you say whether both hold simultaneously? No, both cannot hold simultaneously. And if it holds, the element is same. These are not two distinct elements. Suppose I have taken these two as the distinct elements. Then one can say either M1 F1 is less equal by M2 F2 or this holds. Therefore, may I say every element of the given set is comparable?
Yes, ma'am.
Every element of the set. Or every element, not every pair of elements, I can write now. Every pair of element of the set are comparable, correct now? And if it is comparable, we can say that the set is totally ordered set or it is a chain. See, second point we have cleared. For this partially ordered set, we have found out one subset. Now we have to say that this chain has an upper bound. What do you think? What will be the upper bound of the set? Okay, to find out the upper bound of this chain, what I will do? I will take the union of all the subspaces. That is, suppose, let me continue this explanation in the orange. Suppose I have this kind of subspaces. M1 subspaces of M subspace of M2, so on, so on. Somewhere it is MI subspace and somewhere it is MN and so on. And accordingly, these are the extensions. Correct, na? Correct, na? Accordingly, these are the extensions. To find out the upper bound for the given set, what I will do? I will take the union of all these subspaces. May I say it will be the bigger set then? All those are contained in union MI. Okay, and whatever is the set defined on, whatever is the functional defined on this union MI, I will call it as F0 set. Okay, therefore, this union MI is containing all subspaces, and hence it is the upper bound of your first chain. Now we want to find out the upper bound of the second one. Therefore, may I say if union MI is the union of all subspaces on which F0 is defined. Therefore, may I say this F0 is extension of the previous functions. What is my upper bound on this set? Therefore, I will write this chain has an upper bound. Again, today the printer is not working. This chain has upper bound. Okay, to find out the upper bound, what we have done? We have taken union of all the subspaces over I. And what is F naught? F naught is a functional defined on this union set. Where? What is F naught of X? F naught of X is defined as Fi of X for all X in Mi. What is the meaning? Check. F naught, let me put I equals to 1. F naught is equal to F1 on M1. What is the meaning? F naught is an extension of F1. Correct, no? If I put I equals to 2, F naught equals to F2 for all X in M2. Therefore, it gives you F naught is an extension of
F2 on M2.
Correct, na? Because it's also an extension. Is it okay? Understood the upper bound?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Upper bound we have defined of this set. Now, what? According to Zeson's lemma, we have defined an upper bound. Then, what Zeson's lemma tells us? This X has maximal element. That is, this set P has the maximal element. So we will write simply, this is okay. Before that, here I will write, since we are considering why this is an upper bound, I will write, since we are considering total ordering on S, right? Huh? Due to this total ordering itself, this upper bound is defined. Correct, no? Of here, union MI is subspace and F naught is functional. Therefore, can I say it is well defined also? It is defined. Correct, na? And this is true for every totally ordered subset. This is true for every totally ordered subset. Can you find out the upper bound for every totally ordered subset like this?
Yes, ma'am.
This is true for every totally ordered subset of P, hence by Zeson's lemma. Hence what mathematician Zeson tells us. Yes? Hence, by Zeson's lemma, P must have, what P must have? P must have maximal element. And say it is M bar and capital F. The maximal element we have taken is capital M bar and F. Okay. Now, what is my last claim? If this M bar coincides with capital N, then proof holds. Capital N will be the whole space and F will be a functional defined and this will be an extension. But what is my claim lastly to show M bar is equal to N? To show this M bar equals to N, we will assume the contradiction. Let us assume that M bar is not equal to N. Not equals to N. What is the possibility?
Subset.
Very good. Somewhere here it is M bar and we were saying it is not a maximal. Then M bar will be a subspace of N. Okay. Therefore here can I write, let M bar be a subspace of N. Or rather it is proper subspace we will call. This is properly. This relation is going to hold properly. If this relation is going to hold properly, may I say we can find out one element X naught in N, which is not in M bar. Correct now? which is not in M bar, and we will form one subspace formed by or spanned by M bar and X naught, and we will call it as say M naught bar. We will call it as say M naught bar, and we will apply Hambana lemma. Right? Let me go for writing this. Then, as per Hambana lemma, I'll write shortcut HB lemma. We can extend capital E in such a way that I'm going to extend M bar F is related to its next space M naught bar and F naught. Okay, where? What is M naught bar we have formed out? Where M naught bar is space and by what?
M bar and X naught.
M bar and X naught, and X naught is an element in N, not in M bar. Okay, so for what we have obtained, M bar is a subspace of M naught bar. Correct now? M bar is subspace of M naught bar, and F naught is an extension of M. Correct? This implies M bar is subspace of M naught bar, and F naught is an extension of capital M. This is what we have obtained from this assumption. Correct now? But if M bar is a subspace of M naught bar, what we have written this maximal element of the set P? M bar F is the maximal element. Therefore, whatever M naught bar we have written, what will be the relation between M naught and M naught bar? M bar and M naught bar. Due to this maximal element, M bar sagat mottha hai, maximal hai. Subspace madhe sagat mottha hai. Then what should be the relation between the two?
Same.
Yes, they should be same. Since M bar F is maximal element. How can I forget it is a maximal element? No. We must have. What we must have? M bar equal to M naught bar. Okay. If this holds, this contradicts the fact that M bar is a subspace. And F naught is an extension. Because if it is not subspace, this is not an extension. Which contradicts the fact. Which contradicts the fact. Which contradicts the fact that M bar subspace of M naught bar. Okay? And why this contradiction arises? Due to a wrong assumption. Hence our assumption is wrong. Which assumption we have made?
M bar not equal to M.
Yes. Assumption M bar not equals to N is wrong, therefore M bar is equals to N, and capital F is an extension of small f. Okay, hence what we have proved? There exists an extension capital F on N, which is extension of smaller, okay, such that what is the relation between the norms? Same, no, because this lemma itself tells you, Hambana lemma, norm is equals to norm of F. Okay, yes, any difficulty with the proof? If you have, you can ask me. If you have a confusion about these norms, here I have not mentioned it actually. Coming to this H. If F2 is an extension of F1, what is the relation between their norms? Equal. Right now? If F3 is an extension, this norm is equal. Likewise, we were extending this to F naught. And later union Fi, union Mi and F naught is the upper bound, and what is the maximal element we have written? M bar F. So for this, whatever norms, all the norm values of all the functions are same. Therefore, it is equal to norm F as well. Okay. Hence the proof of Hahn-Banach lemma. If you have any difficulty with the proof, you can unmute yourself and ask. John's lemma var apan purna proof dile baga. Lakshat yete ka?
Yes, ma'am.
Are you having difficulty?
No, ma'am.
If not, we will go for some consequences of the Hahn-Banach theorem. In the consequences, what we were going to show, we were going to show the existence of given functional on the whole linear space. Non-linear space. Consequences of Hahn-Banach theorem. That is, by using the theorem, we were giving the existence of functional on the given space, right? Result 1 we will discuss. What the result 1 says that, let N be a non-linear space over K. K may be anything, either real or complex. X naught be any non-zero vector in N. Then prove that. What to prove? There exists a functional capital F in N star. Let me just focus on the word in N star, such that F of X naught is equals to norm of X naught and norm of F is equal to F1. Okay, we wanted to prove the existence of such a functional F in N star. What is N star?
Dual space of N.
Yes, that is collection of all bounded linear functionals from N to either R or C. Therefore, wherever I am saying F in N star, what is the meaning? F is functional defined on
N.
Yes. Therefore, either one can write functional F on N star or functional F in N star. Both are same. Here I will write F in N star is equivalent to F on N. Correct? Now, we wanted to give the existence of one functional capital F in N star, and what we have in our hand, only X naught be a vector in N. This is the only thing given. This is capital N. And a non-zero vector X naught is provided, and it is asked us to find out the functional capital F on N. Correct, na? F, capital F, we wanted to find on N, which satisfies these two conditions. Therefore, as we were not knowing the nature of elements in N, what kind of non-linear space it is, we don't know how the what is the norm defined. In general, we wanted to prove. So, we will take the help of Hahn-Banach theorem. Hahn-Banach theorem. What we will do, we will find out one subspace of this N using X naught, and we will define a functional on that, and by using Hahn-Banach theorem, that functional can be extended to a functional on the whole space N. Okay, see, X naught is a non-zero vector given, no? Somewhere here it is, say, X naught. Now what we will do, we will try to find out one subspace generated by X naught, and we will call it as M. Okay, generated by X naught means what? What is the nature of element in the space M?
X naught plus M.
No.
X naught, ma'am. Singleton.
Singleton X naught tar ala. Baki cha elements ka shasti. Kaay samto vector space tumala. The vector space is closed under addition and scalar multiplication. And continuously I can do. That is, if X naught is an element, what about X naught plus X naught?
It is also an element of M.
It is in M. x naught plus x naught plus x naught three times?
Also in M.
Therefore, may I say any scalar multiplication is in M?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
As we have only one element, I can write any. Suppose you have any, in general, if you have any set, say A, which is a vector space, A is a vector space, spanned by any two elements, x1, x2, say. How you are writing an arbitrary element of this set A?
Ax1 plus ax2.
Ah, and that is what my question, no? Alpha x, alpha 1 x1 plus alpha 2 x2. This is what a general element you are writing, no? But here we have only one point with us. But what will be the nature of element in my set M?
Scalar multiple of x.
Very good. Alpha x naught, alpha is in K. This is the set I have. Now, we know the nature of element in this set M. Therefore, it is easier for us to define the functional on M. Therefore, what we will do? We will define a small function F on M. We will prove it is a functional. Once I prove it is a functional, F I will define on this M. Once I prove this is a functional defined on M, by Hahn-Banach theorem, can I extend it to capital F?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. If what is the methodology in this proof? With the help of the element given, we will form one subspace. Later on this subspace, we will define one function. We will prove the function is functional. To prove it is functional, how many conditions to be verified?
Continuous, linear.
Those two conditions, right? Linearity and continuous or boundedness. Later, we'll just apply Hahn-Banach theorem to extend it. What is the relation between the norm values of both these? Norm F is equals to norm of capital F. Correct, no? A relation between the two functional, norm values of two functions. Correct, ma'am? Yes?
Yes, ma'am.
Now, while defining small F, we will take care, capital F will be defined accordingly. डिफाइन करतानाच काळजी घ्यायची की कॅपिटल एफ असा आला पाहिजे स्मॉल एफ डिफाइन करताना. ओके, लेट अस चेक हाऊ वी आर गोइंग टू डील इट. लेट व्हाट इज गिवन, इट्स नॉट बी अ नॉन झिरो वेक्टर. इफ इट इज झिरो, इज इट पॉसिबल टू फाइंड आउट दिस सबस्पेस?
नो मॅम.
पॉसिबल, बट हाऊ मेनी एलिमेंट्स इट वुड हॅव?
Only one element.
One element, that is singleton zero, right now. Okay, therefore here we will start with this. Okay, then what we were going to define? A subspace M formed by X naught, alpha is in K. Be a subspace of. Once I know the nature of element of the set, it is possible for us to define the function. But we cannot do this for N directly. Because we don't know what is the nature of element, we don't know how the norm is acting. Nothing is known about N. Therefore, we have taken the help of Hahn-Banach here. M we have defined. Now, what is the next job I am going to do? Define F on M to K. First condition is assured, it is scalar value. It remains to go for linearity and continuity, right? Three conditions are there actually. Define F from M to K by. F should be defined on an arbitrary element alpha x naught. Look at this capital F we wanted to show. We wanted to show capital F of x naught is norm of x naught. Knowing capital F is an extension of this small f, one has to think how I can define small f. Okay. Therefore, see here, I will try to define F of alpha x naught is alpha into norm of x naught. Okay, check. Then if capital F is an extension, what will be capital F of X naught? Extension means what? F of X is equals to small f of X on M, na?
Yes, ma'am.
Let us deepen. What is F of X then? According to this definition.
Alpha into norm of X naught.
No, this is mere F of small X naught. And this is 1 into X naught. देखो दिस इज 1 इनटू नॉर्म ऑफ एक्स नॉट, करेक्ट ना?
यस मैम.
राइट. देखो बाय लुकिंग एट दिस एफ ऑफ एक्स नॉट टू बी डिफाइंड, वी वर डिफाइनिंग अवर स्मॉल एफ. जे प्रूव करायचे त्याच्याकडे लक्ष ठेवायचं आणि मगच स्मॉल एफ डिफाइन करायचं. ओके. इफ आय डिफाइन लाइक दिस कैपिटल एफ एफ ऑफ एक्स नॉट विल बी नॉर्म ऑफ एक्स नॉट डिफाइंड. लेट मी कम टू द क्लेम्स. ओके. वॉट इज माई फर्स्ट क्लेम? That is linear, right? F is linear. To prove linearity, what I will do? I will take two elements, y1, y2 of the domain. Okay? y1, y2 of the domain and delta b any scalar taken from the field. Then can you tell me what is y1? Element of this type, na? Or is it, is say alpha 1 x naught and y2 be say alpha 2 x naught for alpha 1 alpha 2 in k again, correct? Now what should I start up with? Then I have to consider the linear combination of the two elements in the set m y1 plus delta y2 say. And we wanted to show this is f of y1 plus delta f of y2. So let me write the elements. This is alpha 1 x naught plus delta times alpha 2 x naught. We know the how this function works. If it is a scalar combination of scalar multiple of x naught, that scalar taken as it is and multiplied by norm of x naught. So for here also I will take x naught common. Therefore, what is the scalar used? Is it okay? Then how the function is defined?
Alpha 1 delta into alpha no, alpha 2 into norm of x naught.
Yes. This is by definition of here. Okay. Now just separate, multiply. Alpha 1 norm of x naught plus delta times alpha 2 norm of x naught. But what is alpha 1 norm of x naught?
F of alpha x naught.
Alpha 1 x naught delta times f of alpha 2 x naught. But f of alpha 1 x naught is y1 and alpha 2 x naught is y2. Hence what we have proved, f is
linear.
Now let me go for my second claim, boundedness. Bounded or continuous, one can show anything. Let me go for boundedness. We will start with an arbitrary. Boundedness means what kind of statement to be shown actually?
F of x less than or equal to mod of f into norm.
Or some constant norm of x, right? Na? Therefore, let me start with any arbitrary element, say y in m. Let y in m, which implies y is some alpha x naught for alpha be any scalar. Okay, therefore let me consider mod of f of y. Y we have used because y is the symbol I have used previously for the elements of m. For mod of f of y. Yes, this is mod of f of alpha x naught. But already we have proved function f is linear. Or let me use the definition directly. This is alpha into norm of x naught by definition. Okay, so can I write this as mod alpha into norm of x naught? Scalar is taken out with the modulus, right? Ma? Or simply separating modulus over the product. Mod alpha into norm x naught. No need to write modulus for the norm because norm is always a non-negative quantity, right? And what about norm of y? This is norm of alpha x naught, which is equals to mod alpha into norm of x naught. Therefore, from this two, may I say mod of f of y is exactly equals to norm of y. Can you say the function is bounded or not?
Yes, ma'am.
Because here we wanted to show less or equal. And what we have shown here? equality. What is the value of the constant k? 1.
One.
Therefore, may I say the function f is bounded? Okay. Therefore, thus, f small f is a functional defined on capital M. Okay. Let us find out the norm value of the function also. Let us find the norm value of the function also. What is the norm value of the functional norm f? Definition of operator norm.
Supremum of mod of f of x such that norm x less than or equal to 1.
I will use y, okay? Y. Because y symbol was taken. Next, y is in m. Normal s equal by m. Here I will take equal to 1 because I wanted to show it is equality. Third definition I am using, no?
Yes, ma'am.
No, second one. Second definition of operator norm. Okay. Now, what we have calculated just now, mod of f of y is norm of y. No equation number given previously, let me call it as 1. So here I will write norm of y provided y is in M and norm of y is equal to 1 by 1. Okay, why I have taken norm 1? Because actually our aim is to show norm of capital F is 1. If I wanted to show norm of capital F is 1, what should be the value of norm of small f?
1.
Therefore, I have not taken less equal 1. Now, supremum norm y such that norm y equal to 1. What's the supremum value?
1.
Okay? Norm f we have shown 1. Now, third claim I will make is, I will try to find out the value of f of x naught. Or claim I am writing, therefore I will write equal to. Why equal to I wanted to show? Because the aim is to show capital F of x naught is norm of x naught. So consider, how can I show F of x naught is equal to this? May I write x naught in terms of scalar multiplication as 1 into x naught. According to the definition, this is 1 into norm of x naught. Hence equal to norm of x naught. Okay? Now let me go for last claim. What is my last claim? Capital F is a functional on N such that okay. Therefore, we have defined once functional on the subspace of N. Now by Hahn-Banach theorem we can extend it. Therefore, here we will write by Hahn-Banach theorem a functional F defined on capital M can be extended to can be extended to a functional capital F on N or in N star, one and the same in on N such that, what such that? What is f of x naught? F of x naught is small f of x naught defined as norm of x naught and what is norm of capital F? Norm of small f which is equals to 1 and hence it is the proof. Is it okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Any difficulty? Sadha sopa hai bola. Functional capital N var shodhayche aahe mhanun mi aadhi ek subspace define kela, tyachyavar ek function define kela aani mag tyachyavar ek function define karun tyacha extension kela. Sadhi gosht. Okay. Same ashas ajun don results hai. Kiti vajle? 230. It's not possible to cover the remaining two results. We will cover it in the next lecture. Let us stop it here. Any difficulty if you have, you can ask me. Tamastaika, khoop sapa padhvini sankhe nuhi.
Yes, ma'am.
good. Let me stop then. Thank you for being with me.